Hey everybody, on today's show, we have home improvement expert, Kohler spokesperson, Ed Del Grande. You might know him from his show, Ed the Plumber, on DIY Network. He is going to share with us today the number one thing you need if you are a homeowner that you might not have thought of, or you might not have gotten around to, and also the three things that will add value to your home. I know a lot of us are doing a lot of upgrades because we're all living from home and working from home and doing everything from home. So he is gonna share with us the three things that will add value. Tune in, it's gonna be a good one. Oh, and remember to subscribe and turn on the notifications. Hello, hello everybody. Welcome to Better Together. When you know better, you get better. That's what we try to do here every single day. Our quote of the day: the power to affect your future lies within your own hands. That's Nido Cubin.
Nailed it. I'm giving you some really hard Latin names.
Did I really nail it? You know how they say it?
No.
Oh, Kelsey. Can you imagine?
Sounded like you nailed it.
Nido is Nido. Like, no, it's not Nido, it's Nido. And I'm Nido. Like, I don't know which one it is. Anyway, the power to affect your future does lie within your hands, everyone. That is the theme of our show today. I'm very excited about it. We have master plumber, home improvement expert, Kohler spokesperson, comedian, Ed Del Grande. He's going to be talking about taking back your power and how the power really does lie in your hands. Whether it's your home, your life, your job, it is in your hands. Plus some great DIY hacks. I noticed someone was asking for some DIY hacks from Kevin.
Yes,
Kevin believes that he's not alive anymore, so we needed someone else to step up for Kevin. This morning I was laughing at him on FaceTime this morning. I'm like, honey, people think I'm hiding you. There have been people on Instagram who are like, why are you hiding your husband? I'm like, what does that mean? You think I have him locked in a closet?
You want to know what my favorite thing is? Reading through your comments on Instagram sometimes. These people are crazy. Some of the questions, I'm like, what is happening?
Well,
so funny. Or when... I mean, it was last summer too, when we were in Connecticut and everyone's like, where's Kevin? Where's Kevin?
I know. I know. They just don't understand. It's been 23 years, so we can be apart a little bit more than the norm.
Right.
Plus we know we have a mission right now. So I was telling him how not only do I feel like a widow because he's gone. This is just the running joke. He keeps telling me now his new thing is, did I die of COVID and maybe this is all just a dream because he's in the middle of construction, you know, on a roof doing all this stuff. And he's just like, I just want this to end. I'm just tired and I just want to be with you and watch TV. And I'm like, I know, me too. But I was laughing because I said, you know, I have to go drop off the car to get its oil changed and tune up and all that. And I got to go pick up my rings because not only am I a widow, I'm ringless.
Supports the theory.
Yeah, exactly. People are going to see me with no ring. They're going to be like, they're definitely done.
They're done.
It's over.
I'm going to leak that to the tabloids.
You could. So anyhow, yeah, I am very, very excited because we, years ago when we started AfterBuzz, we bought this house like a mile down the road from here and or maybe more, I don't know, very close. And we started doing our podcast out of there. This was like 12 years ago, maybe more. And then, you know, eventually we got too big. We had to go buy it like a small building and, you know, set up AfterBuzz in there. And then what ended up happening is some of our employees ended up living at that other house, or we would rent rooms, like whatever. There was all kinds of stuff. And so finally in COVID, my dad and Kevin freshened it up, updated it so we could sell it. And it finally passed yesterday. I'm doing my happy dance.
So inside. Exciting.
I can't drink anymore, so I can't celebrate with booze.
Well,
I was at dinner last night. I go, I want to celebrate with my sparkling water.
I mean, I'm right there with you. So it's not as fun. But like,
drinking really isn't fun anymore when it doesn't make you feel good.
Yeah, I know.
So, I mean, I can have my Casamigos little drink. I can have my tequila soda. You know, it's sparkling water, lime juice, and tequila. I can do that and I can feel fine. But it's when you go out, nobody makes it like me. Unless I go to a Casamigos event, because their bartenders are bomb and they know how to make it amazing. So
it's tough.
So yeah. So it's, you know,
just that. But I did celebrate my happy dance. And, you know, real estate is a really great way to invest. And what's great about today is obviously we're going to be talking to Ed about DIY. If you can do some of the work yourself, which we do all of our own work for the most part, there are things we have to farm out, of course, but we really do our own work. It's a little bit of a gold mine, guys, mm-hmm. right? Like we almost tripled our money on that property.
Wow.
And that's how our first property that we lived in, we tripled our money and then we bought this. So investing in real estate is cool because, you know, it's always going to appreciate if you buy, obviously, in the right areas, in the right kind of house. It's kind of like an investment account, you know, it wasn't even just a bank account. Sometimes I looked at it as a bank account, but I was like, actually, it's an investment account because it's giving me money back, technically, not officially in my hands, but it's building equity. So it's not just sitting in the bank making 0% interest. So, you know, Kevin always says real estate is real. My godfather has always been buy real estate. So I'm seeing the benefits of having invested very young into something like that. And, you know, now I can take this and there's something called a 1031 exchange, if people don't know about it, ooh, where you have 45 days from the close of escrow to identify a new property. And so I'm looking at some business
properties.
And then
properties. You put it into there, right?
Yeah. And then it's tax-free. Your earnings or your gains are tax-free. And so everybody always wants to do that because you don't want to give away money for nothing. So we'll look at properties that will then be paying rent while I'm sleeping. You want to be making money
Hell
while you're sleeping.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the idea. And then if we don't find anything, we'll have to just pay the taxes and it is what it is. But I think that when I look at all of our property that we've bought over the years, even this house, when we bought it, the realtor told us, he came up to me, he goes, "Your family's crazy. Do not buy this house. It needs so much work. It's going to cost so much money."
Wow.
And I looked at Kevin and I looked at my mom and dad. I go, and I'm like so anxiety. I go, are you sure that you can do this? And Kevin goes, "Yes." My dad was like, "Maria, come on." And within like a month and a half, they had like torn through this house. And it was crazy. I mean, they did everything on like a shoestring budget. The realtors couldn't even believe it. And of course, now you see it today. And it's been 16 years, I think, of upgrades little by little. But we've been able to do most of it ourselves. So that's money in your own pocket every time. So I called my dad. He didn't answer yesterday, but I was like, "Kevin, please tell him I said thank you." And then I thanked my mom because she did work over there too. But real estate is really, really cool. I am definitely in a place now where I want nothing that requires me to work with them because just getting that thing closed is like everything was just going wrong at the end. And so I'm glad it's over with, but being able to, you know, do your own renovations and your own updates really makes a difference when you have your real estate. Cause then if you're spending so much money, you're not going to make money at the end of the day. If you're having to spend to like update it yourself and all of that.
No.
So anyhow, I'm excited to chat with Ed. I think he's going to be my new best friend.
I think so too.
Because
he's awesome.
Yeah, because that's all we do is renovations. Now I say we guys, just like I say we, when the New England Patriots are playing, I'm a part of the team. When the Celtics are playing, it's we.
Maria, your dog is farting in the booth right now.
Oh, God.
I'm sorry. I had to tell you.
Oh,
it's so
Winnie.
Bad.
You know,
she's on my lap.
She actually had a solid stool today, so she might not need to go to the vet.
Oh,
there might be
girl,
some gas Vincenza. Going in there, but let's pray she doesn't poop on you.
Oh my God.
You can crack the door so the stink comes out. You don't have to like suffer
hot
in there.
Hot box in here.
Yeah.
Anyways, sidebar.
Hilarious. Anyhow, I was watching, actually I'll say it when he gets on. So taking the power back, it was funny when we were in Connecticut last summer, Kelsey and I, we kept losing power one time. I think it was 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we had like a small generator. I had bought my parents one years ago and it powered the kitchen, the front hallway, the like screening room turn, garage turn screening room. And that was pretty much it.
Yeah.
So we were lucky we even had that, right? Because the refrigerator is so important. But we really just, it was hard because it's hot and we had no AC. And I was like, this is the pits. This is not happening anymore. And I am going to make some adjustments here. So my Kohler generator showed up. We were very excited when that thing showed up. It's like 80,000 pounds. I got the biggest one. I'm like, I want the biggest one. I never want to deal with this again. And I felt like Superwoman. I was very excited. So during the most recent storm that Kevin and my dad had to weather, that was pretty bad. They never lost power. Because my Kohler generator turned right on and I was very excited. I got it because I knew with my mom, I never wanted them to be in a bad situation with her being sick. So I was like, okay, we have to deal with this. We have to do this. And so today we're going to chat with Ed about that and more. He's a 3-time master plumber, home improvement expert. And of course, Kohler spokesperson. He's the premier go-to guy for virtually anything contracting, gas piping, plumbing, or home remodeling. That's why he's going to be my new best friend. Ed has more than 40 years of experience in natural and propane gas piping, which would have come in handy when we were figuring out how to do this whole thing. But it is figure outable. And he's the host of his own television show, Ed the Plumber, on the DIY Network. Program host on HGTVPro.com. He's the author of Ed Del Grande's House Call, and he is an expert resource for home enthusiasts all over the country. Ed, the Heal Squad welcomes you. Can you heal our aversion to plumbing, I would say, and propane? I'm kidding.
Well, plumbing and propane piping, it's like anything else in life. You work at it, you figure it out, you find a way. And if you keep trying, even if you have some stumbles along the way, you'll be successful.
I love it. Ed, you've had such an interesting career. Like, you come from a family of plumbing, right? And then you're like, I want to be a comedian. I don't know how that went over with your family. I'm sure not great at first because they probably wanted you to be a part of the family business, right?
Well, I was doing the comedy at night when all the clubs were open, and I was doing the plumbing during the day. And surprisingly, I started getting more and more work with the comedy, and I really liked it. And my mom sat me down. She said, you know, you're having fun with the comedy, but remember, you got to get your master licenses in this business because that's what's going to give you a good life. And when you start show business and your own mom says, keep the day job, you know that maybe you should keep the day job and try to do both at once. And it turned out to be the best thing in the world because after 10 years doing the comedy at night and getting my master plumber's licenses during the day, when Home and Garden TV started up in the early 90s, I was prepared and ready to go. So I'm one lucky plumber.
That's amazing. I know you hit it right at the right time. And, you know, most people would rebel against their mom at that point, and especially when it comes to like fame and all the excitement and the allure of it. But it doesn't hurt to have your license as a backup.
Oh, not at all. And, you know, a lot of the comedians we started off with, Dennis Leary was down there, Bobcat Goldthwait, Lenny Clark from the Boston area, I'm sure you know it. They were a great group of guys. But then there's some other ones who were very funny, but they didn't catch their break, and they really had nothing to fall back on. So I was very comfortable having the plumbing licenses, and even though I had to work harder and do my work during the day, those licenses, I mean, they gave me my career right now with Kohler. If Kohler was not going to work with somebody who wasn't a master plumber, someone in their business. So my mom was right all along those 40 years ago.
Yeah, for sure. You know, you also, you have your own show on DIY, and I don't know how, is DIY an official spinoff of HGTV?
Yeah, started off with Home and Garden TV.
So they're family.
Yes, they're family. I started off on a TV show called Dream Builders with Home and Garden TV in the mid-90s, then The Fix in the late 90s. Then DIY was a great place for Home and Garden TV to do a lot of their repeats and shows. So that's where we did Warehouse Warriors, which was a fun, it was like a junkyard type war show. And after that came Ed the Plumber. And so that's where DIY came from. And those early shows are no longer airing. Like everything else, the networks change. But that was the good foundation. And it was Ed the Plumber where I was able to meet the great people at Kohler. And for the last 17 years, I've been traveling around the country talking about water conservation, generators, backup power. So it really was a great journey. If it wasn't for all that stuff, and especially the stuff my mom told me, I wouldn't be here talking to you today for Kohler.
That's so funny. So we have Paul the Plumber. is that like a thing? Do we just call all of our plumbers like John the Plumber, Ed the Plumber?
I don't, back then, nobody was doing anything. Matter of fact, to this day, I'm the only person that I know of that had an all plumbing TV show, a national TV show. It was just plumbing. So Ed the Plumber maybe started that trend, but whatever caused it, I think it's a lot easier. It makes it more personal with your plumbage. You could call up Paul the Plumber. You could call up Ed the Plumber. Yeah. I knew an Al the Plumber as well. So I think that's a good trend to have in this business.
For sure. For sure. So, you know, when I got my generator, I was so excited and I felt like Superwoman because I was like, you know, we need to take the power back. And I was like, ha ha ha. And I wasn't even like thinking about it in those terms. But when I say something sometimes, I'm like, oh, what a great pun. Like, this is so funny. Take the power back. But it's true. I think for women, you know, we sometimes kind of like, oh, that's, you know, Kevin's job. That's my husband's job, or that I can't do that. That's, it's so intimidating. And it was intimidating for me at first because I'm like, how do I know what to get? Right. So how do you help women feel confident when they're, you know, kind of handling some of these things, whether it's, you know, a generator? Obviously, you know, it's not that we don't see women in DIY or renovations. Obviously, you watch any of those networks, you know, there are so many incredibly talented women. And I've been around renovations my whole life. So, and I've popped in and done stuff with my family. But you know, it still can be an intimidating process having to know whether someone's scamming you or like, is it really going to take all this work? Are they just saying that because they want to make it look like this? And so talk to me a little bit about, you know, at least like first we'll start with generators and, you know, why it's important to, kind of take that power back and say, you know what, if you don't have somebody, you don't have a husband, you don't have anybody, like you don't have to live with the power going out and begging the company to like get your power back up.
Well, the good thing about generators, any homeowner needs to know the basics, and we'll get into the basics. We'll talk about sizing. Speaking of sizing, yes, yours is a very big generator. The one in Connecticut is 48 kW. Now, Maria, just to put it in perspective, and this is where we'll start with sizing, is 48 kW. The kW stands for kilowatt, which is simply 1,000 watts. So that's a 48,000-watt generator. So picture a hairdryer. You can get smaller hairdryers that are about 1,000 watts. Your unit, if the power went out, you could run 48 hair dryers if you wanted to. So that's a big unit. My own house, in the average size house, would probably use about a 20 kW. So that's a 20,000 watt generator. And that one will do about an average house. But here's the deal. When you get into standby generators, because we can touch base and will on portable versus standby, this is a professional installation. Mm-hmm. So it's good for all homeowners to know the basics of a generator system. But what's going to happen is you'll have a dealer come down. They'll size up the generator for you, give you a price, work to your local codes, because this is going to be permanently connected to your house's electrical system. And that's why I love standby generators so much. It really isn't something where homeowners will get in trouble with. You'll have a professional install it. You'll know the basics as far as sizing. They'll size everything up. And so when you're dealing with a good, reputable dealer in your area, everything should be all set because they're doing it by the book.
Yeah. So mine's obviously huge. What does a 20 kilowatt? A 20 kW power. How many square feet?
Well, here's the trick. And this is why we're going to explore a lot of things today. You can't go by square footage. You have to go by the power load. Mm. And that's why it's so important for the professionals to size it up. My own house, I have a gas oven, I have a gas dryer, so that's going to be less of a draw on the generator. So you go by the power load, mm-hmm. not by the square footage, but to give a ballpark, an average house usually goes about 20 kW, and that's for a whole house generator, which means it's going to run everything, the air conditioning, the heating, and so forth. But you don't have to go with the full whole house generator. You could go with selected circuits, mm-hmm. and this keeps the cost down, and you could just do the essentials that you need when the power goes out. So that's why it's so important. You could go to places like KohlerGenerators.com. They'll send your local dealers in who know how to work with the local codes and the local inspectors, and they will size everything up for you and get the installation and the quote all set for you. But what's important, and this is why I like to go around and educate people, is just know the basics of a standby power system. Work with your dealer, and you're going to be just fine.
Yeah, I think, you know, for us, we have studios and we have so many things. So our power load is a lot higher than most average homes. But we did have the generator I initially got from my parents at that house was on the circuit breaker with like limited rooms. So we only had a few. But what happened was my mom had stage four brain cancer and I was like, I can't have her not have power in her room. She's going to have medical equipment and things, we just have to make sure she's okay. And that became even more of a thing when by the end of the year, when she got COVID and it was really like a bad time. So I just knew that with our kind of family health crisis and stuff, there was just no messing around. The entire house needed to be powered. We were all there caretaking. We were all, needing power. And so I'm really grateful we did it. I think it's like a hard pill to swallow sometimes because things are so expensive. You know, you have to buy the unit, then the installation. Like for us, we had to build a new cement pad and we had to get new propane tanks and, you know, do a whole underground system. So it can be pricey. There are ways around it, like you said, and there are smaller units that aren't going to require all those things that I just needed. But you know, is it something that you suggest people do? Like if they're buying a house, do you just add it into the mortgage or something?
When we first started off building houses with my dad, this is back in the 70s, nobody had central air conditioning in houses. It just wasn't done around here in Rhode Island at that point. Now, here we are about 35, 40 years later. We don't build a dog house in Rhode Island without central air conditioning.
Yeah.
So, yes, you hit the nail on the head. This is the future. This system, as far as looking at the cost of all other house systems, it's a very affordable system. And you're going to see more and more houses be at least generator ready, if not the generator installed. So this is the wave of the future, especially now where we lived in a plugged in society. And you can't afford to be without power if your kids are getting homeschooled, if you're working from home. It's not like the old days where we had game boards and board games and we used to light candles and it was kind of fun. Losing power just for a few hours now can disrupt the life. So you hit it right on the head there, Marie, that this is going to be the future.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, yeah, it's like we're all, our home is our office, is our school, it's everything now. And the weather is getting so crazy.
Yeah.
And volatile.
Well, to follow up on that now, because the first part of your question, you did talk about being able to afford it. There's a lot of cases, and I'll tell you an issue that a situation that happened to me when I was at one of the home shows. There are situations where you can't afford to be without it. Mm-hmm. We had a couple come up to us, and the gentleman was in a wheelchair, and it was a wheelchair that had some life support systems on him that he needed to keep the battery back up. But if that went, he would be having some troubles. And they told me, and I mean, my heart, I felt so bad for them. They said they would sit in their living room during storms in the winter, hoping and praying that the power wouldn't go off. And that's where you really can't afford to be without these generators. And I said, you know what? I know you're worried about the cost, but we have some dealers right here who are local. Let's see what we could work on. There's always dealers who work with payment plans. They have some specials. They can work around the systems. And you can make it work. This is something that's so important that if you're a homeowner and you need to have that backup power, you will have people, and especially your local dealers, who will help you. And it can be affordable in most cases. And the return you get back, it's just going to be volumes for what you put out. And it's an investment in your home. So it's not like the money's going to go away. When you go to sell that house now has more value because of that backup power system.
Yeah. I wonder if you like, if you've lived in your house forever and you're like, all right, weather's getting volatile. We're all working from home now. It's like a whole different story, you know? And by the way, I think even just us talking about this is going to kind of spark that conversation within people, because it is really important. And it is one of those things that maybe people aren't dealing with or haven't really kind of faced yet, but this is the reality. Weather is volatile now, and it's going to get more and more volatile. We are now doing everything from home. So a generator is going to be way more important than it ever was. So maybe it's like a lot of people take equity lines on their properties, right? At some point you take an equity line, you want to go buy something, you want to do renovations to your house. Keep in mind that you can take a little bit more out and get your generator and make sure that you're safe forever. And like you said, it is increasing the value of your property. So you're not going to lose money on it. It's not like the generator depreciates the older it gets either. It's just they're doing its job when it's time.
Yep. Now remember the sizes. And that's one thing I love with the Kohler line is that they have sizes just for about every application. You could start off at a 6 kW for the selected circuits, which is a very affordable system. And now you are about at the mid-range where 48 kW. Hmm. Maria, they even have situations where you could go up to 150 kW and you have the whole line of generators to choose from. So like you were saying, no matter what your budget is, you have home lines of credit you could tap into. There are some loans. There are dealers who are going to work with you. So in most cases, you're going to be able to afford this necessity.
Yeah. Also, another thing that I've learned in my investment life, right, is if you have an investment portfolio, you can sometimes borrow off your investment portfolio at a very low percentage rate. So when I ended up buying the lease for my car, my investment guy goes, you know what? Let's just take the loan off your investments. It's going to be less than 1%. And, you know, we'll just start throwing chunks of money at it and pay it down. I was like, I never knew you could do that. Like, I have this little investment portfolio. Instead of, you know, getting a loan and you know, whatever, having it be 3%. So if you have an investment portfolio, that's another way you can do it. You can take a little loan off of your investment portfolio.
You know what? I just like what you mentioned. You relied on your investment person to help you out and to get you down that path. And that's what I love about standby generators is you are working with a licensed professional to install them. And they're like your investment counselor. They'll be your generator counselor and help you go down that path. So even if you don't know too much about mm-hmm. generators, you do have the help with the standby generator because you're not doing it yourself. And I think that's an important segue to go into is a lot of people don't know the difference between portable and standby generators. Mm-hmm. So we could go down that path right now and I could guide people to let them know exactly what a standby is and compared to a portable generator.
Yeah. Oh, and there was one last thing before we get to that. You have to maintain your generator, right? Like once a year, they have to come do like a routine maintenance.
Oh, yeah. That's what I have one at my own house. Now, here's where all the smart technology comes in. And this is pretty cool. Once a week, that generator has a little computer in it. And a standby generator will come on and test itself once a week to make sure everything's up and running. And you could even monitor it with your cell phone now. They're very smart generators. You could don't even have to be there. You could start your generator and see how all the systems are working. So the generators do turn themselves on once a week as an exercise just to stretch the legs a little bit if it hasn't run in a while. And that way it's in tip-top shape if you have an emergency event. But like you said, that's important. It's just like your automobile or anything else. Your dealer or your service person for the standby generators will come down once a year, change the oil, check the systems. So it's not like anything that's going to be a pain in the neck for you to maintain. It's going to pretty much take care of itself. And then once a year, the dealer will come down and just check it out for you.
Okay, cool. So let's talk portable versus standalone.
Standby. Standby. Now, standby is the ones that are connected permanently to the host, but we'll start with the portables.
Well, the standby, just so everybody knows, the second your power goes out in your neighborhood, your generator turns right on. That's what standby means. It's like, we're right there. Boom, it goes on and you literally coast. Like my husband and my dad had a storm, their first big storm, and I was really nervous about it. And just in general, like, you know, trees and falling and all that. But I knew they were going to be good electrically. We had just gotten it all hooked up finally. And like maybe 2 weeks before. And the generator turned on and everything was magical. So, but there are portables, and we have had portables for different things. We've used a portable one here in LA when our power went out once. And even my husband used our truck and got power from the truck, brought it in. I don't know. We've gotten very, very resourceful with things.
Oh, well, yeah, people do get resourceful. And that's what I love about how a lot of homeowners have all their kind of like tool arsenal in case anything happens, they're ready for the situations. But the cool thing, like you just mentioned, when you do deal with a permanently installed system, it's basically automatic. They come on and off by themselves. And that's a good place to start with the comparison with the portables. Now, a portable generator, you're familiar with them because they're usually on wheels and people have seen them all over. And they're good units. They're great. I mean, they're great for tailgating. They're great for camping. You could use them, like the name says, for portable situations. In a pinch, they will power up appliances in your home. You have to make sure you always run them outside, far enough away from the home, which is usually at least 20 feet, but keep them away from any houses. And then you run heavy-duty extension cords into the house directly to each appliance, one appliance per cord directly plugged in. You do not touch the electrical system in the house at all, and that's how the portables work. Now, standby generators, they're permanently installed like we've been talking about. Mm-hmm. They come on and off automatically. But instead of running on gasoline like the portables do, where you have to keep filling them with gasoline, they run on natural gas or propane. And those are self-feeding fuels, which means they just keep putting the fuel in automatically. So when you talk about a system that will be hands-free and within 8 seconds after you lose power, turns the power back on your house, that's a big difference between the system you have to set up outside, run extension cords, and fill with gasoline.
Yeah.
So there's the big deal right there. And there's where the price difference is for the systems. The portable is just like the name says, good for portable powers, good for power in a pinch. But the standby, that's part of your house. That's part of your system. And it's your own personal power plant in your backyard.
Ed, are there any installation hacks people should know about?
I don't like to do any installation hack advice. You always do things by the book and by the local codes. But I like fun hacks. And one of them is if you ever lose power in your house and you don't have a portable generator or a standby generator, and you need to keep the food in your refrigerator cold so it's not going to spoil, this is a great hack. Do you know your washing machine is a good cooler? Pick up the lid, take the clothes out, fill that bucket with ice, that wash bin, and you can put your food in there and ride out the storm. It's insulated because it's double walled. And when you're done and all the water melts, just pump it out, turn on the rinse cycle. So your washing machine in a pinch can act like a good cooler to keep your food set. So those are the kind of hacks I like, hacks that are fun. They can help you out. But when you install anything, I don't like the word hack. I like the word go by the codes, go by the book.
Well, that's why I like Kohler has people that can come out to your house. They tell you what you need. They'll set you up with everything you need to do it. And they're a trustworthy brand. And so I think that, you know, you can't ask for anything better than that. But I do think it's really important that people start to face kind of the realities of what we're dealing with and with our weather patterns. And, you know, it makes me so sad to think that those people were sitting in their living room on pins and needles, wondering whether they were going to have power. I don't think a lot of people kind of know what's available, don't think it's a lot of work or just it's something that's not top of mind. And I feel like this is actually kind of a non-negotiable because it just what we talked about nowadays with the weather and with the fact that we're all at home now and home is everything, school, work, you know, life. I think it's a non-negotiable now. So I think if you haven't dealt with your generator lack yet, this is the wake up call for you to go out and look at the different options, see what you guys can live with, right? My parents were just fine with their smaller generator when my mom was healthy. When my mom was healthy, they were totally fine. They are survivors, unlike me. I'm kidding. They were like, we're fine. We don't need power in every room. But, you know, if you've got a full house and you've got someone ill, it's a different story. And you don't need that added stress in your life. That family did not need to sit in that living room shaking and scared. There's always a way to do something with, you know, a payment plan or trying to get some equity out of your house, or, you know, if you have an investment portfolio, you can borrow off your investment portfolio for a smaller amount. Whatever it is you have to do, is kind of your, you know, it's important.
Oh, you know, and it doesn't even stop with your host. I got to work through Kohler with General Russell Henry. I'm sure you've heard of him. He was the one who went down to New Orleans, Louisiana after the hurricane, and he got up and straightened it out. And, you know, a very intelligent military guy. And he talks a lot about standby power in generators. And he started off his speech, I'll never forget it. He said, if you have a standby generator and you're the only person in your neighborhood with a standby generator, you have a chance to do one of the greatest things in life, and that's to save another life. And it's not a stretch to say something like that. If somebody is elderly and they need air conditioning and they can't have it in their house, but you could come and sit in your house and cool off. If people have medications that need to be refrigerated, mm-hmm. you can help them. And that was great to hear him speak about the generators and being a military man and seeing all the stuff that he's seen in his life. To equate having a standby generator with being able to save a life is absolutely true. And that moved me when he said that.
Yeah, very true. Very true. I know when we lost power in Connecticut, my husband was like, I told the neighbors if they want to come stay here because they had power because of our amazing generator. They were safe. So, and the same thing here, we haven't had a generator here. We got ours finally. We just have to wait for my husband to get back and we'll finally figure out where we're going to put it, where we're going to install it, because we have no idea where it's officially going yet. But my neighbor bought a huge system like this. And he's always like, if power goes out, you guys can come here now. I've got power. And so I'm like, I want to have the power. So I think I would love to get any other kind of cool DIY hacks for the ladies listening. I know that some of our listeners have been asking for any kind of DIY tips. I was watching your videos last night. I now know how to install a misting system. I never thought that would be so easy, but it seems really simple when you do it and I'm watching it on YouTube. And now with California heat being so crazy, I feel like I live in Vegas all of a sudden, Ed, but I'm in Los Angeles, I swear. But I think I'm going to install one of those misting systems in my back porch.
Oh, they do work. And it's just such a simple concept that's been around for hundreds of years. The water, when you atomize it and it's in the air, it absorbs the heat around it. So you don't get wet. It's not like sitting underneath the shower, which is pretty cool. It's spraying out water, but you're not getting wet. It's just absorbing the heat. So yes, Marie, those misting systems do work. And as far as hacks, I don't want to call this a hack because it is a little bit of an installation, but you're getting like a spa-like experience in a regular shower. Shower heads have come so far nowadays that they have a head, Kohler makes one, it's called the flip side. Mm-hmm. And this is actually four different shower heads in one unit. It's not like you're just changing the direction of the spray, the volume of the spray. It's four completely different experiences. You could change one shower head in your shower and turn it into a spa with this flip side unit. And so that's another type of the hack that I like, where for the price of a shower head and maybe about 45 minutes of your time, you could turn any standard shower into like a little mini spa.
I like that. I like that. Do you have advice for women who are dealing with contractors? Because I feel like sometimes, you know, you kind of feel like you're dealing with the car salesman that's like,
yeah,
charging you extra percentages and you don't know anything about it. What are some great ways to help us as we're dealing with contractors?
What I like to do, go right to where they work. A lot of people don't know about, you do have an option to go down, especially if you're going to buy your material off them. The local plumbing supply house, the salesperson that you talk to, they're at the supply house, the same places the plumbers or the contractors going to. So no matter what the field, go to the supply house. Let them know you're going to give them your business, and they're going to be open to you to give you some names of people to go there. Now, remember, the names they usually give you are going to be good customers of theirs. If it's a bad customer, they're not going to go promoting a bad customer. So start getting the different names from different supply houses and look for a name that keeps coming up. A lot of different contractors and plumbers use many different supply houses because each one maybe has its own specialty. So if you keep hearing that same name come up that a supply house is telling you, that's a good place to start. The second thing is, don't be shy about this. Always ask for the insurance. Make sure that their insurance, see their insurance card and their licenses. So any good contractor is going to be proud to show you their license and their insurance because they're working hard for this. So always go licensed and insured and good recommendations from the local supply houses and even friends and neighbors.
And then multiple bids, right? You want to get multiple kind of looks at something?
Absolutely. If you have somebody who, let's say, just did work for a member of your family and they had a great experience with them, that's good to have someone that you know works. And in that case, you might want to, if it's not that big of a job, just get the price from them, see the best price they can give you. But yeah, it's always a good idea to get a few bids and tell them right up front so you're honest with them. Also, a cup of coffee goes a long way with the contractor, believe it or not. I can't tell you the amount of times I've gone over a house and just a simple gesture like, can I get you a cup of coffee or a soda? You know, it could be a little hot that day or a little cold and a coffee or tea would taste good. That really brings a little bit of a personal relationship into it. So don't be shy to ask for licenses and insurance. Hmm. Don't be shy to offer them a soda or a cup of coffee. But look for the prices. If they're all good, reliable contractors, they're going to be close. Watch out for the ones that are way out of the curve. Like if something is way too high or way too low, that could, you know, give you a little flag to watch out. But in most cases, the contractors that I've worked with all over the country, the contractors that I've seen here in my local community, they're going to be good. They want to help you and they want to work with you. But do that. Get the prices first. Don't go into a job with no price. Usually that doesn't work out too well. I just had my roof done at my house and I know who was going to do it. He was a great guy and I've seen his work before. So I knew he was going to have the job. But I needed to have that price first just to keep us both in line. Here's the page that we're on. So use your head, use your business sense as far as pricing, and use your local inspectors and your supply houses if you have further questions. But last thing I can tell you on all that is if somebody wants to do a job that requires a permit and they don't want to pull the permit, that's another thing to watch out for. Permits are there to help the homeowners. It's another set of eyes with the inspectors to check that house out. And it's also doing everything by the book. So if you have to call your insurance company later, they're not going to say, well, where was the permit for this job? Permits are there for the homeowners. So use good contractors to pull permits.
What if your homeowner doesn't want to get permits?
I can't tell homeowners what to do. It's their houses. But what I can tell them is that that usually doesn't end well if there's an issue. And let's say there was a problem. The first thing they're going to look for is the permits. Who looked at this? Mm-hmm. I mean, even if the homeowner's doing the job, go to your inspectors to pull the permit and get that inspected. Homeowners, it's their house. I can't tell them either way. But you're always taking a chance if you don't do things by the book.
Yeah. All great tips. I had one other one I wanted to ask you. Oh, so with everybody wanting to renovate now, right? I feel like we're all in our homes, like I said, more than ever. And we want everything to feel better that maybe didn't feel good before, but we were all running around and we weren't experiencing it 24/7 like we are now. So talk to me about what actually will increase the value of your house. So that we're very clear on the big ticket items that will actually give you money back.
There's three right off the bat: kitchens, bathrooms, and standby generators. Those are all proven to add value to the house and get a good return. Now, anything you do to your house naturally is going to get the return, but I don't have to tell anybody this. They've seen it themselves. When you have a newly remodeled kitchen or a newly remodeled bathroom and it's going up for sale, that pulls a lot of weight in that house. So if you're looking to do the best, if you have to do one project, keep it to those three to get the best investment back. My opinion.
And then is there a tip in terms of how to renovate one of those items with long lasting kind of appeal? Because there are a lot of trends, right? Like in kitchens, there's like a whole trend now to like paint cabinets like navy or like some version of blue, which we might be doing in Connecticut right now. I'm thinking we're going to do the bottom cabinets like that and then the top ones white. But are there trends to be aware of that, you know, may not have lasting effect?
Well, that may not have lasting effect or that will have lasting effect?
That may not.
Oh, well, like I said, now, if you're going to be in your house for a while, if you want to go crazy with colors, that's a lot of fun, but that may not have a lasting effect. I mean, I can't tell you how many different colored toilets from the 70s I ended up removing in my career. If you want fixtures that will always be in style, from what I've seen, white or off-white just to always seems to be attractive and in style. And keep it to the lighter colors. A lot of good, dark, rich colors. They're a lot of fun and they're trendy, but you don't know what the trends are going to be like in 30 or 40 years. So if it's going to be short-term, go crazy with the colors. If it's going to be long-term and you want to get the best investment back, keep it to that white or off-white for your fixture colors.
Yeah, I saw it recently with a friend who redid her house. And I mean, it looked like Architectural Digest. It was so beautiful, but it was very specific because she used a lot of color and a lot of patterns. And it was a very distinct kind of look. And it was a very big challenge for them to sell it because you need that right person to come in. If you have a pretty blank palette, your kitchen's white, everything's clean and simple, you're going to have a better chance, I think, at moving a property faster.
Yeah, and also getting back to the generators, when people go in and they know that that's coming with the house, that I've seen that firsthand when I've been at different houses and seen with some of the real estate agents advertise. And when you go in and you know that right from the start, you're not going to have a power outage at your house, that gives you a lot of bang for the buck.
Yeah. I love it. Well, Ed, I'm so excited we got to chat today. We're going to have to come visit you in Rhode Island, Kelsey and I, next time we're out there.
Absolutely. I don't think we're too far away. I'm in Northern Rhode Island, but Rhode Island's so small. When you say Northern Rhode Island, it's just 10 minutes from Southern Rhode Island.
Exactly. We're going to be apprentices.
My wife was in it when I left. I did leave my parents' business to start my own for a while before I got into the PR work. And my wife was on the road with me. So there are women in plumbing, and especially now, and I'm so happy to see it. But she worked with me for a couple of years. So I'll definitely, if we have some jobs come up, you can get some wrenches and some overalls and we'll put you to work.
Overalls? How am I going to have plumber butt if I have overalls on?
When I started my business, I'm not making this up, I advertised no bum cleavage. I had a one-piece suit, and I got so much response from this. There was no ifs, ands, or buts. No bum cleavage. So I had a one-piece suit, and it worked.
Freaking hilarious. No ifs, ands, or buts.
That's amazing.
I'm dead. It's amazing. I really just want to have plumber butt for one Instagram shot. Here I am. But you know what?
Well, in my case, it was best I was covered up completely with the one piece.
Hilarious. Oh, man. Well, I do know how to fix my toilet if it starts to run. So I figured that little thing out. And, you know, over time, I've got my my little hacks for things. So anyhow, Ed, thank you so much for being with us today and for sharing all this information. If you guys want to learn more about automatic standby generators or even the portable generators, you can visit kohlergenerators.com. We'll link to that in the summary of this, and they have helpful videos and pricing calculators and all kinds of resources there.
And one more great tip.
Yeah.
When you go to that website, kohlergenerators.com, and this is something you could do yourself, and this is great for anybody watching, they actually have a section where you can plug in the specifications of everything you want to power up in your house, and it will automatically computerize the size generator you need. So you can get a good size right on that website, and you can do that yourself, and you're already ahead of the game before you even talk to your dealer.
I love it. I love it. All right.
Maria, cool. Can I ask Ed one quick question?
Yeah.
Ed, I have had a shower head, a new one. It made me think of it when you brought up shower heads. That's been sitting just uninstalled in my bathroom for months because I don't think that I can do it. Is it really an easy thing to install a new shower head?
Here's what plumbing, I'd never say there's an easy plumbing job, but here's what's great about installing shower heads. The shower head itself is after your mixing valve, so you don't have to shut off the water in the house. The mixing valve is shut off and no water is coming out of it. What you have to be really careful with the shower head is when you take it off, you don't want to disturb the pipe that's inside the wall. And when you put it back on, you don't want to disturb that connection inside the wall either. So you have to be careful of that. You can check out, well, we have different videos on YouTube that you can see replacing a shower head, and it shows you the basic. But as far as a plumbing job, yes, that is a basic plumbing job that you can unscrew one shower head and put it in. Just be aware there is a pipe in the wall you have to take care of. But the good news is you're not shutting down the water in the house. So do your homework. Check it out. I can tell you right now, a lot of plumbers will come down and help you out. It's just a basic service call. And then you know that you've had a professional come in. And what I like about that is while a lot of these professional plumbers come in, they're there to check out other issues in your house, which usually with houses, there's different places to check. So with one service call, you could take care of a lot of problems in your house. But shower heads are a pretty basic plumbing job. And with the new shower heads out nowadays, like I said earlier, it could turn a regular shower into almost a spa-like shower when you use some of these fancy new shower heads.
I'm ready. Thank you. Super helpful.
Well, you can probably talk to your apartment landlord and say, I need this installed. And maybe they have somebody that's on call that can pop in and that'll be easy.
Yeah.
If I could tell you what I told my customers my whole life and other people that I know, if you're not sure about something, call the professional in, but they'll let you watch them in. I know I used to do this with my customers, actually explain how to do things. And once you see somebody do it in person that knows what they're doing, when you see it once, that's like a college course for you. And you'll learn how to do it from them. And the plumbers that I've worked with and the contractors, they're always happy to help the customers, make them a better educated customer, and it's best for everybody. So call up a pro for maybe the first time, but then the second time, tackle it yourself.
There you go.
Thank you, Ed.
Thank you, Kelsey.
Thank you so much. We're going to put all the links in the summary of this for you guys to find. Ed, have a great day. Thank you so much.
You too. I enjoyed myself, and it was a great speaking with you, Maria.
Thank you, too.
Okay, how fun.
So fun.
I loved that, Maria.
I love Ed the plumber. Yeah? Did you feel like you live in an apartment? So the fact that you love that makes me feel good.
I loved it. I feel like it's so cool. What I love about this show, and I feel like we haven't done an episode like this for a while. And it's so cool because like there are tips and tricks. Like I was taking notes for, you know, one day when I do invest in a house or like little things, I'm going to make both my parents watch this. Like they want to sell their house they're in right now. How great was that question of the three things that you could do to add value? Like, I just think that this is so cool.
Yeah.
And I'm dead serious. I've had a shower head that I was like, can I do it myself? I don't think I can. I need to call my dad. No, you don't need to call your dad. You got this.
Yeah.
So I thought you asked amazing questions. I thought that was so fun.
Which dad are you calling?
Well, that's true. Kevin dad would come do it in a second. My dad would probably tell me to watch a YouTube video and walk me through it. Or tell me to call him back when I mess it up.
But I think your Kevin best bet is Kelsey has a note in our office like, sorry, Dad, please don't be mad at me. Love, Kelsey. And it's to Kevin.
I don't remember why that happened, but yeah, it's great. It's a great cute. Note. It's yeah. a cute note. But yeah, Kev will come do it.
I think your best bet is to call your landlord and just say, hey, I have a shower head that needs to get installed and see what they say.
Yeah. And that's so cool. I mean, a service call. Who knew?
Yeah. It's super easy.
Yeah. Yeah. That, I thought that was really fun.
But some of these things just be like, because we don't have like everyday experience in them, they seem so overwhelming.
Yeah.
And you know, that's why we're like even me, the window in my closet, that window has been like a nightmare. And I think it's because when we got them all installed, we didn't know how to use them. And so I like old fashioned wood windows where they just go up and down. These things have like the little slats and they got the little plastic things. I hate them. And so the window was down and I'm like, what? It's 101 degrees out. Like it's so hot. And you know, now my AC is going to maybe break or struggle because I've learned all about AC units. Now that we had so many problems in Connecticut, I understand how it all works. So I didn't want to stress out the system. So I had to like tape the window till I can figure out what to do with it. And I was kind of all thumbs. I'm like, Kevin, you need to come back here. I don't know how to deal with this window. And then I realized, yeah, I think I can figure this out.
You
There's
got this.
A contractor I can probably call. But because I'm not used to doing that, it's not my...
Your forte.
It's not my forte. Yeah. I'm used to Dad, Mom, because my parents are usually here, or Kevin, can you guys fix it? So now I'm alone. I'm like, okay, I got to call a professional. And by the way, there's so many apps now, whether it's like Lug when you need help moving stuff or like contractor apps, you can call like people. But I think there's nothing better you can have in your Rolodex than a good contractor, electrician, and plumber. So if you just move somewhere, ask your neighbors who they use, and that's usually a good start. And so you can find who your people are going to be. And I loved when he said a cup of coffee goes a long way. I now know why all of our people come. First of all, we treat them like family. We feed them. We give them more than just water and coffee. My parents, we used to cook for everybody. Because my parents were the same. Like we're all those kind of workers. So we treat them really, yeah. really well. That's why they always come quick.
I remember my mom used to, even for like our, the garbage guys on Christmas, she would leave like little Starbucks cards on the garbage cans. But like, if there was ever any issue in Seattle too, it's, let me tell you, it's crazy with like the recycling, the compost, you get crazy fines, but they would always come to her and tell her, you know, instead of fining. So it's the same thing, right? It's like nice. You can, yeah, a little bit goes a long, long mm-hmm. way.
Yep.
I also wish I knew about the, what was it? The washing machine hack when my fridge died.
Yeah.
What was that all about?
Great idea.
Crazy.
Right?
So cool.
Yeah. I think, I think here in California, we haven't had storms and issues. There was that one time we lost power and it was kind of fun for us. We like, Kevin, like had an extension cord from the car into the bar and we like slept on a little like, you know, thing in the bar and it was fun for one night. But when we dealt with it in Connecticut for 2 weeks, I mean, that was just the pits.
It was not fun.
It's really very challenging when you are working out of your house and you can't really do anything. We're making coffee off the floor in the foyer, like in the hallway. It was just not great. So I think now more than ever, it's time to really focus mm-hmm. on where are we getting our power from, everybody? And let's figure it out. So I think you guys know I'm a big Kohler fan, and so go check it out. Start kind of the research and the homework, and take back your power. In the meantime, if you haven't hit subscribe on YouTube, please do so you don't miss all the great notifications for the great episodes coming your way. If you haven't joined us on Patreon, great time. To join us on Patreon. We do an extra show every week. You get the ad-free shows every day. And we also have our heel events once a month with the incredible guests that we have on this show that either are not even taking patients anymore or are very, very expensive. And you get this incredible intimate experience with them. Did I miss anything, Kelsey?
No, you nailed it. I think
$10 a month.
$10 a month for the heel events, $10 and up. And I also
really, for the entire package of everything I said.
Correct. You get the ad-free shows, you get the bonus, the weekly bonus, and the heel event is $10 a month. And I also just like to add, and I talked about it actually last week on, or the other week on Regular Guy Friday. Maria and I have been having so much fun with our bonus like weekly episodes. It's just, it's like a fun girl chat. Like mm-hmm. I learned about fall fashion last week. I don't know. I just think that it's really an investment in yourself. That's not that much. We pay. I mean, when I look at my stupid apps that I, who knew that I was paying a monthly fee for some of my apps? I'm like, what? Like I could be investing this, you know, back in myself. So I think that this is like such a fun, good investment in you.
I love it. All right, guys. In the meantime, be nice people, make good choices, and be present.